ladies and gentle women, ladies and everyone in the house, please welcome to the stage Pastor Kelly Dykstra.
Shiny, sparkly people here. This is incredible. How are you? Wow, that was loud. It must be girls' night. I want to know, did anybody else notice Pastor Ted secretly checking to make sure his zipper was up? You didn't see it? I totally saw it. I leaned over to Eric and I was like, Ted totally just checked to make sure his zipper was up. Because Ted's like worshiping, he's like, I truly don't know if he can hear me right now, and I'm really hoping he can't. But Eric's like, yeah, I've checked many times. There are way too many women here to not check your zipper. It's so weird. Oh my gosh, and they think we're weird. Did everybody get a seat? Yes? Good, oh my gosh, I'm so excited. Did anybody see the little bitty, the tiniest hero out doing parking tonight? Whose little boy was that? Is it somebody in here? No? So somebody just brought their little boy to do parking tonight. That is so cool. So like later on when they watch this, because they know, you know, they secretly do watch this, we want the heroes of the house tonight to know that we appreciate them. So let's give it up for the heroes real quick. So how many of you, this is your very first time ever at a twirl? Wow. Well, welcome. How many of you, this is your very first time ever in the building of the Crossing Church? Woo! Well, welcome to you. We don't do that on the weekends, but in Twirl, we totally make you raise your hands. So, okay, I'm so excited. You know, we put these on the calendar, and then about 3 days before, I'm like, oh crap, why did I do that? So, we'll talk a little bit in a few minutes. It's hair in my mouth. We'll talk in a minute about the purpose of Twirl. But first, I want to tell you about the theme for this Twirl. Does anybody know what the theme is? My favorite things. Okay, so I turned 39 on Friday. And so, happy birthday to me. It's my last year of being in the 30s and feeling young. I know there's some birthdays tonight. We'll celebrate those in a few minutes. But I figured it's my birthday week, so we might as well, like, do my favorite thing. So that's why there were Oreos in the lobby, which I only ate three today, I think, because they're like crack for me. Like, seriously, I told Eric, you can't buy those. You cannot buy those. You cannot have them in the house because I will eat them all. Because you think, I'll just have two, three, four. But then if you do your four Oreos and then if there's milk left, you really have to get another one. But then what happens is, as you're in the process of the dipping and the drinking, you run out of milk, so then you get more milk. And it starts over. You with me, Marie? I'm telling you, that's what you did out there? Yeah. So, and the walking tacos, I know, classy, right? But I love them. So tonight we're kind of themed a little bit around things that are my favorite things. So, I don't know, like long walks on the beach. I really don't like walks. I don't like walking in general, but sitting on the beach, I like sitting on the beach. I love summertime. I do not like the snow. I love pizza so much, but better than that, I love Pizza Ranch chicken. Right? Pizza Ranch chicken is good stuff. Now, my favorite thing from Hardee's, now we don't have Hardee's in Elk River anymore, which sucks. It's a dry cleaner now. But there's one in Zimmerman, and so on my birthday morning, my husband drove to Zimmerman and got me biscuits and gravy, because I love biscuits and gravy. I love straws in my coffee. I put a straw in my coffee. I love any dark chocolate except stuff with toffee. Amazon packages and what they bring. These are a few of my favorite things, right? good chips and salsa and guacamole. These are a few of my favorite things. Olives and pickles and bread pans that write smoothly. Thick chocolate milkshakes, but not a fruit smoothie. Kelsey and her friends who wear wacky clothes. These are a few of my favorite things. When my day bites or my kids fight, when I'm feeling sad, I simply remember my favorite things, and then I don't feel so bad. Journals to write in and travels to write of, shopping with Holland and good deals on great stuff, thrift stores and yard sales and country to sing. These are a few of my favorite things. Big fluffy towels and dishware and linens. Good books and crockpots and this guy and kissing. Date night at Rockwoods and shoe shopping. These are a few of my favorite things. When my day bites or my kids fight, when I'm feeling sad, I simply remember my favorite things, and then I don't feel so bad. I simply remember my favorite things. I simply remember my favorite things. I simply remember my favorite things.
That you guys are here today. We just hope that you enjoy yourselves and have a great night with the women in your community. I'm pretty sure we're like required by law to say this, but there are not only exits through the doors that you came through, but also in the front of the room. Also, if you have a child in kids ministry, there are underneath the big screens on either side of the stage, there are little ones, and it will light up with a number if your kid needs you, and if that's your number, you are allowed to go and check on your kid. Also, so as most of us know, ladies really tend to like social media, mostly teenage girls. Yes? Yeah? So what I would like everyone to do right now is get out your cell phones. Get them out. Hold them up so that I know you got them. Cell phones. Yes. Now, I am giving you an excuse to take a selfie and not... Yeah. I'm giving you an excuse to take a selfie and not feel like an idiot for taking a selfie in public. You know what I mean? Yeah. I have that problem, like, all the time. My mom makes fun of me. But take a selfie with your... person who is sitting next to you, person behind you, secretly take a photobomb selfie, you know, like someone looking ridiculous behind you. Do that. I'm going to make a little Instagram video. Okay, I'm going to say 1, 2, 3, and then I want everybody to be like, twirl, yay, woo. Okay, ready? Wrong way. I hate it when that happens. It's the wrong way. Okay. 1, 2, 3, twirl, woo. Nice. So yeah, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, Facebook, I would like everyone to post your selfie with the hashtag twirl, anywhere you want to post it. We would really like the internet world to know about twirl, so that's how it goes. All right, guys. I see some really funny duck face selfies. That's great. Okay, settle down. I'm gonna pray and then let's get rolling, okay? God, thank you for all the amazing, beautiful women in this room tonight. I pray that everyone just has a great time. Thank you that the first opening number went really, really well. That was actually really nice. I pray that these ladies get life-changing here tonight, and that it's just phenomenal. In your holy and precious name I pray, amen. Amen.
Okay, so I'm gonna just give you some actions to do. Just do the first thing that comes to mind. Show me what it looks like to run like a girl. show me what it looks like to fight like a girl. Now throw like a girl.
Aw.
My name is Dakota, and I'm 10 years old.
Show me what it looks like to run like a girl. Throw like a girl. Fight like a girl. What does it mean to you when I say run like a girl?
It means run fast as you can.
So do you think you just insulted your sister?
No. I mean, yeah, insulted girls, but not my sister.
Is like a girl a good thing?
Actually, I don't know what it really, if it's a bad thing or a good thing. It sounds like a bad thing. It sounds like you're trying to humiliate someone.
So when they're in that vulnerable time between 10 and 12, how do you think it affects them when somebody uses like a girl as an insult?
I think it definitely drops their self-confidence and really puts them down, because during that time they're already trying to figure themselves out. And when somebody says you hit like a girl, it's like, well, what does that mean? Because they think they're a strong person. It's kind of like telling them that they're weak and they're not as good as them.
And what advice do you have to young girls who are told they run like a girl, kick like a girl, hit like a girl, swing like a girl?
Keep doing it, because it's working. If somebody else says that running like a girl or kicking like a girl or shooting like a girl is something that you shouldn't be doing, that's their problem. Because if you're still scoring and you're still getting to the ball on time and you're still being first, if you're doing it right, it doesn't matter what they say. I mean, yes, I kick like a girl and I swim like a girl and I walk like a girl and I wake up in the morning like a girl, because I am a girl. And that's not something that I should be ashamed of. So I'm gonna do it anyway. That's what they should do.
If I asked you to run like a girl now, would you do it differently?
I would run like myself.
Would you like a chance to redo it?
Yeah.
Why can't run like a girl also mean win the race?
Mad props to our good friends at Always, who have been saving our asses for a long time. I can only say that at a women's event. I saw that a while back, and those of you who know me know I don't cry a lot, but I actually sat in my car and watched it on my phone, and I just cried, because that so reflects my heart for you ladies, that you would never be ashamed that you're a girl, that you would never feel like you have to measure up to men, that you would never be repressed, because in the past, over the course of human history, Christianity has repressed women. And I think it's time we put an end to that, just like we've put an end to slavery, we put an end to repression of women. And then we women can rise up, because, you know, those are some of those things that you think that are gone. There's no slavery anymore. There's slavery alive and well in this world, and there's something that we can do about it. So one of my biggest hearts is for justice for women who are being abused and oppressed, and justice for women like you who just live in the normal world that I live in, but for reasons that I don't even know, you're abused, you're repressed, you're held back because of maybe it's your own insecurities or maybe it's your life situation. And tonight I'm here to tell you that Jesus Christ loves you. God created you for a reason, and he wants you to thrive exactly as you are. So that's my heart. That's my heart for you, and we want to have a lot of fun now. If you're new to Twirl but not new to the Crossing, you know, at the Crossing we kind of, everything runs kind of smooth on Sundays and Saturdays and whatever days, but at Twirl, we just kind of, like, the reason we do this is because I can't invite you all to my house. I have a lovely home, but it would not work. And so that's why we kind of all get together here. And so we kind of do things in segments here at Twirl. We have some that we do every time, some that we only do when we can think of a creative thing to do. So we're going to kind of just work through it. We're going to meet a couple of new friends. We're going to have prizes, cool stuff, and then we'll leave. Does that sound good? Okay, how many of you had a friend you wish was here tonight? You have a friend you wish was here tonight. Okay, grab your phone and text her. Tell her to go to crossing-church.com, because we're live streaming right now. So shout out to Tracy's mom, Diane Marquardt, and to my mom, Debbie Frazier, and to all of the other friends across the country and across our state who are watching. We love you and we wish you were here. Okay, so text your friend. Are you texting your friends? Go to crossing-church.com, crossing-church.com, and click on the live stream button. That's how it works, right, guys? I forgot to ask somebody. That's how it works in my mind, but so many things work in my mind and don't in other places. So, okay, so here's the purpose of Twirl. You ready? The purpose of Twirl is to thrill women with the truth of their unique design from God and to move them to twirl with open arms and meaningful friendships that together will change the world. That's the purpose of Twirl. And tonight we're focusing on the open arms part, and there will be more about that later. But you know, the part of that video that we watched a minute ago that struck me the most was the lady said, if you could go back and do it over again, would you? And the girl was like, yes, give me a chance to go back and do it over again. You know, when we were little girls, we were free to twirl. We always wanted to wear the twirly skirts, you know? The best skirts are the ones that twirl like parallel to the floor, you know? Like the completely not modest ones. But then, you know, when you get older, you kind of stop twirling so much because you get cellulite. Okay. I get cellulite, I don't know about you. And so we kind of start to like, you know, we don't twirl as fast or as free, and we kind of start, and then we protect ourselves because life kind of beats the twirl out of us, doesn't it? Right? And then we get a little bit worried that if I twirl too much, you know, I might bump somebody else and offend them, or you know, a mean girl might actually trip me, which actually does happen, right? When we're twirling along and then a mean girl doesn't like it and it's, you know. So what we want to do here is just make this a safe place where you can be who you are and we can tell each other that God loves us and empower each other to be who God created us to be. So look at the girl beside you and say, you're God's favorite. I got distracted by my... You want to hear a cool story? I was shopping for my twirl dresses. Dresses because I had to wear two. If one isn't bad enough, I had to get two this time. And I went to a consignment store who's not paying me to say this, but it's called Turnstile. And I went to check out, and I already knew they were cheap, you know, because they were like marked down or whatever. When I went to check out, I got three dresses for $5.57. That was pretty legit. I was so excited. So that dress I had on before was like $2.75. So that was pretty cool. Okay, what's next? Oh, who has a birthday? If you have a birthday, we have a lot of birthdays. Today is your birthday. If today, August 5th, is your birthday, please come on the stage. Give him a hand, everybody. Hey, look, we got steps on both sides this time. Come on up. Oh, how cool is this? Now, we have a birthday tradition, don't we, ladies? Yes? Okay, cool. It doesn't involve this, but we got these, so we're going to give them to you. It's Bumble Bath. What's your name?
Dawn.
And we won't ask you how old you are, so happy birthday, Dawn. What's your name?
Alyssa.
Happy birthday. You get Bumble Bath. Ooh, hello. Lisa! Oh my gosh. Hi! You're here. You came from Texas. Holy moly, happy birthday. And what's your name?
Jody.
Happy birthday. What's your name?
Blossom.
Happy birthday. Okay, so if we're going to do this, you'll have to come over and join everybody else so you're not by yourself. You guys ready? Stand up. Let's stand up for them. All the new people are like, what is happening right now? We're going to do it twice. The first time, you're going to be going, and the second time, you're going to sing along. Okay, ready? Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay. One, two, three. You were born this day. You were born this day. Happy birthday, baby. You were born this day. You were born this day. You were born this day. Happy birthday, baby. You were born this day. Give it up. Thank you, ladies. You can go. You look lovely.
Thank you.
You did good. Cool. Okay, what's next? Oh, okay. So last twirl, we started a new segment. It was called Caught on Camera. Yeah, there's a mixture of awe and awe because, you know, if you were caught on camera, you're going to be embarrassed. But also, if you were caught on camera, you get a prize. So that's cool. So did we get some? Oh, yeah. Okay. Hey, we were all eating. Okay, where are you? Right here. Okay. You win, just for being caught on camera looking adorable, you win a haircut with Jenny Lee at Avalon Salon, who is my hairdresser. She's awesome. And then 31, is that what it's called? A 31 organizer planner. So way to be awesome. But at least you got a good gift out of it, right? So cool. Okay, now we started another segment, the last twirl, called Songs We Sing Wrong. Yeah, how many of you have said, I'm up till 9 to get lucky? Yeah, that's Eric's favorite. Up till 9, but 9:05. So, look at Pastor Ted running. Oh, I'm in this one. That's great. It's okay, there's something else first. Okay, so we kind of had a list, like, you made the rice, I made the gravy, but it might just be a tuna fish you're looking for. Okay, but we're not going to do that one, because it took too much time. Okay, so in order to fully appreciate this song that we're going to ruin for you, we felt like you need to see a video clip first. And this video clip is from Friends. Everybody knows Friends, right? All you old people like me. Okay, it's from Friends. And what has happened is Joey accidentally drinks some fat that was in the refrigerator. He thought it was like a milkshake or something. So Joey accidentally drank some fat. So it's sitting on the table, and then the ensuing happens. Now, the only YouTube clip we could find of this has Serbian subtitles. So if English is your second language and Serbian is your first, this is just for you. So take a look at this.
Well, I don't care. The only person I cared about getting dressed is the one person that says she's not even going to go. Look, Rich, I'm sorry, okay? Look, I was a jerk, okay? I'm sorry I yelled. I want you there. I need you there. Look, what... what can I do to show you how much I want you to be there?
You could drink the fat.
All right, welcome to an adult conversation.
No, wait a minute. That actually, that sounds interesting.
What?
I think you should drink the fat.
Yay! Okay. Okay, if that's what it takes to show you how much you mean to me and how much I want you there, then that's what I'll do.
Ugh, wait, let me get you another glass that's been sitting out.
I think this will be fine. Okay, vanilla milkshake, just a vanilla milkshake. The chicken bits floating in it. Cheers.
No, I'll go.
You will?
You were really gonna do that, weren't you?
Well, yeah.
You were gonna drink the fat.
Let's see what else he'll do.
Right? You ready for this?
I think so.
You got it?
I think I'm ready.
Okay, so he's gonna sing it, and then we all have to sing it the second time through.
The song
good?
Will be ruined for you for the rest
ruined
of your life.
Ruined forever. Not that it was fabulous in the first
Although
place.
I will say this. The song is kind of ruined just because of the way it is anyway for me.
Yeah, he's a music snob.
But anyway, okay.
It's true.
Cool, we got sound, we got microphone.
Everybody knows it's gonna be one of those. I can drink the fat all night. That's the stuff I like. That's the kind of party makes you throw your hands up high. About the time one on, talking gone. Turning all the wrongs into right. I can drink the fat all night.
Yeah, okay. Right?
Yeah.
Okay, now you have to sing it
now
so it sticks.
Sing it with me. So the lyrics are up there, right? Did you see that?
Yeah, we got it. We got
you
lyrics.
You see them?
They're coming.
I want you to overpower my voice, all right? Now that you know the words. The correct words. Let's go ahead. We're just going to make this a thing. These are the new words for the song, all right? Yeah?
Yeah, totally.
All right, let's
go
sing these together.
It.
Ready?
Ready?
You guys ready?
Yeah. Are you ready, ladies?
I don't sound ready. Okay, there we go. Woo! Here we go.
Everybody knows it's gonna be one of those. I can drink the fat all night. That's the stuff I like. That's the kind of party makes you throw your hands up high. About to tie one on, talking gone, 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 turning all the wrongs into right. I can drink the fat all night.
Woo! That is fabulous. Thank you. Thank you. I realized why he had to check his zipper, because he's used to holding a guitar.
It's true. It totally, like, covers any problems up.
Okay. We have another caught on camera. Who is it? Oh, she's so busy Instagramming. So I have for you a simple journal, and I wrote it to help people with studying their Bible, sort of. Oh, okay, then you can give it away, which is fabulous. We like to look for opportunities to help abolish human trafficking. And so one of the companies that we've supported is called She Rescue Home in Cambodia. And so we ordered some twirl bracelets. When you buy one of these, you're supporting those anti-trafficking campaigns. And then we have a team that's on the ground right now in Haiti at our orphanage. And so the necklaces that are this style are from Haiti, and that supports not only our orphanage because of the money that we make with this, we send to them, but also the people who made it. So that's a big package there. You're welcome. What's next? Oh, okay, this is a segment we've actually done every single twirl since the inception of Twirl, which, by the way, this is the 10th one. This 10th twirl, twirl number 10. And it's, does anybody want to guess what it is? Things That Twirl. Yay. Everybody say Things That Twirl. Wow, that's cool. Okay, so does anybody remember some of the things we've done that twirled?
Umbrella.
Umbrellas. What? A toilet bowl, water.
A blender.
A blender. Okay, I can't remember. Anyway, so today, toilet paper rolls. Yeah? Toilet paper rolls twirl. It cannot work, you know, stretch it. Just work with it, okay. So recently I was in my friend Amy's office, and Amy is our finance director here at The Crossing. Yes, she's awesome. And she had this awesome art on her wall. Here's what it looks like. Isn't that cool? You guys see it? Ooh. I know. And what does this have to do with toilet paper and things that twirl? Well, this is made out of toilet paper rolls. Isn't that cool? I've drank so much water, I just keep burping right now. So, Amy, why don't you come up here for a second? Give it up for my friend Amy. Okay, so Amy is going to just give you a quick overview of how to achieve this with something that comes in this, which we see all the time. So, okay, go. What do you do?
Just
you
like
you
that?
Can talk, yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So obviously we take toilet paper.
Yeah.
And what I do is, they're about 4 inches long, so you can mark them out. And if you can't cut straight like I can't, then I kind of make multiple marks. So when you press it to cut it, it works better. So anyway, this is really simple, you guys. Anybody can do it.
But it looks so cool.
It does look
pretty cool. It does look pretty cool.
So then you just take your tacky glue.
So tacky.
Right? Everybody has tacky glue, so everybody can do this project. Really? Ah, oh, jeez.
I have a hot glue gun. Will that work, or is that not
well,
a good
you know,
idea?
You could hot glue gun, but here's my thing.
Okay.
I don't like picking.
Oh, all the strings. Have you ever glued your fingers with hot glue? Oh, my gosh. Right? Yeah. Okay, I should get some tacky glue, or possibly just ask you to help me with my crafts.
Oh, well, yeah. I could probably help you.
Okay.
So you can do many designs. You guys, I found this on Pinterest. Like, so simple.
So much on Pinterest.
So much on Pinterest.
You can lose your life looking at Pinterest.
You can, like, these, when you put three of them together, they make great corners.
Oh.
Okay. You can make them look a little bit different. You can squish them more so that they're pointier, or you can round them more, whatever you like. Or you can just keep going and just keep putting it together. And it's really up to you. I mean, you could fill up the whole frame or you can leave it blank. Like I painted my office orange.
Yeah, it's great.
And so I wanted that color to pop.
Well, it looks like wrought iron.
Yeah.
Doesn't
and
it?
And that's the trick, though. You have to spray paint it black because that's what hides the seams of the toilet paper rolls. And obviously a frame from Goodwill, and boom, you're done.
That's awesome. Give her a hand. Thank you very much, Amy. Here, you get a bubble bath.
Oh, okay.
You're welcome. Okay, who here is super picky about your toilet paper? Really? Are you guys? Yeah. Well, we've been using like the same kind of toilet paper for kind of a long time. And I just started branching out because I found that Costco has a pretty decent one, and you know, they're pretty cheap and stuff. But okay, so who's picky about your toilet paper? Okay. So, I want to go with somebody like way back in the corner. You have something on your head. Who is that? Yeah, that's you with the sunglasses. Okay, you want to come on up? Yeah, cool. Okay, good. And then somebody from way back over here, like all the way, let's see. Oh, you have sunglasses on your head too, so we'll pick you. Yeah, there you go. Yes, cool, you can come up. And then how about, somebody, come on, raise your hand. They are all pointing to her and she's going, pretty sure you gotta come up. Hi. Okay. So this is how this is gonna work. 2, 3. Does she? Oh, I couldn't even see him. Hello. Okay, what's your name?
Jara.
Hello, Jara? That's a cool name. Hello, what's your
Tiffany.
Name? I already know your name, but I just thought I'd ask. Okay, tell him your name.
Alicia.
Alicia. Okay. All right. So this is what we're gonna ask you to do. We're gonna ask you to identify. Where's the one? Okay, one. Oh, hey, one. You know, when I put it all on this tray, I was like, this is gonna be easy. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 4, 1, 4. Holy cow, I feel like one of those people like, well, guess which shell has the peanut? Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Good, is that working? Okay, so these are your cards to label those. You can just like put it on top or in front of, you know, like whatever. You know what I'm doing? Okay, so you're going to, you can lick it, smell it. There are four kinds. They are Angel Soft and Scott and Charmin and White Cloud. And you decide which one you think it is, and the winner wins a fabulous prize that I have to remember what it is. We need music. Is there any music? Somebody sing. I could drink the fat all night. Oh, it's a terrible song. Pastor Ted tried to convince us to dance to What Does the Fox Say Tonight? Okay. Who would have thought that was a good idea? Who would have thought that was a stupid idea? Okay, give me your best one-handed dance move. Nice. There might have been two hands there a little bit. I always feel so stupid when I go back and watch this later. Okay. Okay, this is lovely. Okay. Okay. You hid your answers. All right, so we've got, all right, you've got 1, 2, 3. This is fabulous. Okay. All right, so you know which ones you had on which? Number one is White Cloud. Did anybody get that right? Oh. Well, number one. Okay, everybody go wah, wah. Okay, so take number one down. Number two was Scott. Did anybody get that right? Woohoo! Okay. Did you? No? Okay. Number three was Charmin. Oh my gosh. No? Nobody? Okay, take your number three down. Number four, obviously, Angel Soft. You got number four right. So we have a tie, 1 and 1. You each got one. Okay, do you know how to play rock, paper, scissors? Well, it's not like I can invent a new kind of toilet paper for you to do. Okay, so this is what you're gonna do. You're gonna go 1, 2, 3, and then you're gonna shoot. And you either do rock, paper, or scissors. Okay, you ready? One, two, three, shoot. Okay, let's try it again. Change it up. Change it up. Ready? One, two, three, shoot. All right, scissors beats paper. Give it up for Alicia. Okay, so you get bubble bath. We got a good deal on bubble bath. What can I say? And you get bubble bath. Give them a hand, everybody. You can go. Guess what? You've won. You have won a year's supply of Charmin. Yay! Isn't that awesome? Her kids are like, yeah! So, congratulations. You don't have to take it right now. It's okay. We'll keep it backstage and we'll get it to you later. Give her a hand, everybody. Thank you, gentlemen. There's so much stuff. Okay. We have a third and final caught on camera. Which one? Oh, putting the Oreo in your mouth. Who is that? Where is she? Oh my gosh, she's so like, oh, way to go. Come on up. Okay, come on up. Give her a hand. You have to clap longer. She's not here yet. Peter's helping you up. He's quite the gentleman. Okay, what's your name?
Amanda.
Amanda. Okay, you've won a haircut with Carla at Avalon Salon, who is also in here tonight. So yay, there she is. You've also won a twirl bracelet from She Rescue Home and also a journal from She Rescue Home. And their website is itsnotokay.com. Everybody say itsnotokay.com. And so this is a journal. So we have the journals and the bracelets available for sale to support them. And then you get a twirl bracelet. So yeah, there you go. Sometimes it pays to look a little ridiculous. Okay. So now we're gonna do a segment of our show that sometimes we reserve for like fashion stuff, but I'm not very fashion-y. Does anybody want these? Okay, here. Yeah? Yeah. I want the toilet paper! We ran out at home! What are we gonna do? Oh my gosh. I throw like a girl! Those go pretty well, don't they? Yay! Well, that felt good. Holland, come on up. We're gonna do how to pull that off. Everybody give it up for Holland. It's a dance. How did they sneak it in there?
My microphone on. Oh, yay.
Yeah, you're on.
I just ate one of those walking tacos finally, so I feel like there's like Doritos in my teeth. I'm like,
let me see. You're good.
Oh, really?
Okay. You look good.
Yeah, thanks. I just put on lip gloss.
I'm just kidding. Okay, so.
What does that mean?
I said your hair looks nice.
That's what she always says when that's a lie. That's not
true. Your hair does look nice. It should because Jen fixed it today, so you better be careful. Okay, so. Are we mother and daughter or what?
Wait, no. I know what to say. Okay. First of all, I'm going to teach you all something that I want you to be able to remember, okay? One cup of sugar, just like Kool-Aid, one cup of sugar, 2-quart pitcher, 5 tea bags, 7-minute soak.
Can you do
Everybody
it?
Do it with me, ready? One cup of sugar, 2-quart pitcher, 5 tea bags, 7-minute soak.
Good. Yes. So we're teaching you how to make Southern sweet tea that my mom makes it. So.
Yeah.
All right, go for it.
What are we doing?
You do it. I'm just watching down here behind my table.
No one knows what's back here. I feel so special.
Yeah. Oh, where's your other pitcher?
Oh gosh, where's the other?
Oh, we'll do it in here. That's okay.
Well, there's sugar in there, but
oh, hey, cool. Thanks. That's great. We'll use this.
I was smart to do that.
We know what we're doing.
Yeah. Okay. So first, you get like a little bowl of what? I don't know what's. Oh.
Go ahead.
You're supposed to twist that. And I did actually end up breaking that pitcher. Okay, sorry. That's not my pitcher. Anyways, So first you end up putting a little bit of water into the microwave and you just put it in until it boils because the water must be hot in order to dissolve the sugar.
How much sugar?
So 1 cup of sugar. Right. So you just put a little bit of hot water in the microwave, enough to dissolve your 1 cup of sugar. It does not cut. Yeah, that's enough to dissolve the sugar, Mom. So then after your water is hot, we pretended to put that in the microwave, it's hot. And then you pour in your sugar. What are you doing? Oh, yay.
Okay, do your tea bags.
And while you're waiting for your water to heat up, you can open up your tea bag.
Okay, so you start with a small amount of water and you put it in the microwave and let it boil. You get it out and you put how many tea bags in it?
Five.
And how long do you soak it?
Seven.
Cool. Nice. Meanwhile, you prepare how much sugar?
Meanwhile.
Great. And how big is your pitcher? Just like Kool-Aid. Which is terrible, because that means this has just as much sugar as Kool-Aid. Okay, so you soak your tea bags. You can just soak them in there, now that we got it open.
They're soaking.
Okay, everybody do the Jeopardy theme song.
I'm pretending I know the song.
All the old ladies know this. How many of you have never heard this before in your life? Aww,
I think someone's
babies.
A little pitchy. I hear
someone's
someone
a little
being
pitchy.
Just
a little bit. Okay, you soak your tea bags for how long? Cool, and then you...
And then you pour in your hot water into your sugar. And the water must be hot in order for it to dissolve.
See, that's the difference between southern sweet tea and northern sweet tea, is that in the south we know to dissolve our sugar in the hot water because then it dissolves instead of sitting in the bottom. Right? Okay.
Then so, instead of using like a big wooden spoon or something, you're going to want to use just a little spoon.
If you're using a small
This is actually bowl. Kind of a large spoon.
It is a large spoon.
Yeah.
Okay.
And you have to dissolve your sugar into your water.
And when it is fully dissolved,
the sugar must be dissolved into the water, like 100%.
Then you add it to your cold water.
Yeah, this is probably going to...
Pour fast. You've got it. It looks a little weak because we faked it, like on those cooking shows.
I wonder what that tastes like.
Don't taste it.
I dare
it,
you to try it on stage.
There's some out in the... Did you guys try sweet tea? How many of you got sweet tea when you were out there? Okay, so there's some out there. Okay, so now what happens, Holland, if your pitcher isn't full enough yet?
If your pitcher is not full enough yet, get cold water, pour it into a separate container, and then pour it in here to fill it up to 2 quarts because if you just... put it in right from the sink, then it'll get the foam on top, and that makes it taste bitter, as a lot of people say. I'm not really sure, but yeah.
That's what Grandma says, so we believe it.
That's what Grandma says.
Pretty sure she just mocked me.
No!
Okay, so, cup of sugar.
Quart pitcher, hot tea bag, 7 minutes soak.
Cool.
There we go.
And you always dissolve your tea in what? Water? Hot water.
It should not be this color.
No, this is
the wrong color. If it's that color,
don't drink it.
Don't
run.
Drink it. You will die.
Run. Run away. Thank you, Holland. Give it up for Holland, everybody. So now you can open your gift bag because we've given each of you a kit to make your own sweet tea. Did you get it? You get a mason jar because that's the best way to drink your tea. Yeah? Cool. While you're in there, there's a note sheet that you can use in a few minutes for our talk. But I think now would be a really great time for a 60-second dance party. What do you think? You're holding glass on your lap, so be careful and set it down. And we're going to count down from 10. Ready? 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Woo! Did anybody else graduate in 92? Yeah! Oh, sweet. That was so cool when I was in high school, but I grew up in a super conservative family, so I didn't listen to it, Mom. Not even in Brother Lamar and Miss Pat's house. I'm in so much trouble. Okay, what's next? Okay. This one, I think we've done this segment every twirl too, and it's called That Proverbs 31 Chick. We only say chick because the B word is not very nice. Here's the thing. If you grew up in church and you grew up in faith, many of us heard a lot about that Proverbs 31 chick, because in Proverbs chapter 31, there's kind of this list of this ideal woman. She does this and she does that and she does this and she does that and she does it all in high heels. You know, like there's just all this perfect stuff. And like on Mother's Day, the male pastor would always preach about how all the women should be like this Proverbs 31 woman. And I would say, I mean, she's a wonderful woman, like this woman. She is impressive. Like I would like to be like her when I grow up. But the truth is, nobody's that woman, right? Like nobody can uphold all those things. She rises while it's still dark and gives food to her servants. Anybody else have servants? Because I totally don't. You know, her lamp burns late into the night. How do you stay up all night and get up early? I cannot do that. That doesn't work in my world. So like, I got a little frustrated. I'm like, I kind of had that little rebellious thing, that church girl who grew up hearing about this and then thinking, I can't live up to that. So it just makes me feel bad. And so what I decided was, we can't really just throw something out of scripture just because we don't necessarily like it or we get a stinky attitude about it. So we decided that for every twirl, we would just pick one thing about this woman that we can maybe emulate, that we can work on, and that I can handle. You know, we can handle one thing at a time, right? I mean, how do you eat an entire Sarpino's pizza? One piece at a time. Because truly, I mean, it really is a beautiful passage about some really neat ideas, things we can aspire to. So each twirl, we just pull one little topic out of there and generally stretch it around to make it fit whatever it is we want to talk about. But pretty sure we've used this verse before, but it worked so well with what I wanted to do tonight. And so that Proverbs 31 chick for Twirl August 5th, 2014 is Proverbs 31:20, and here's the verse. She extends a helping hand to the poor and she opens her arms to the needy. I like that, right? She extends a helping hand to the poor and opens her arms to the needy. You know, the truth is that no matter how poor we think we are, how little we have, the truth is we already have so much more than somebody else. Because anytime we compare ourselves to somebody else, we will decide we're either rich or poor, depending on who we're comparing ourselves to, right? Yeah, because it just depends on who you look at. Compared to a rock star, I'm super poor. Compared to a homeless person, I'm super rich. What? I mean, what are you gonna do? So what we have to know is that just for our own lives, we're each responsible to God for ourselves. And something that we can always aspire to is always, when given the opportunity, being willing to extend a helping hand to somebody who needs when we are in the place to be able to help. Does that sound about right? Yeah, that's reasonable to me. Now, there is a woman here at the Crossing Church who I've known for several years, and I think she exemplifies this verse, and she's come through quite a journey. And so what we did was we asked her if she would share on video for us tonight just a little bit of her journey. Now, her journey looks different from yours, it ends different from yours, and of course it continues on. But I think that in her story, we can see a little bit of something that's for us. And so I would love for you to watch Jessica's story.
I'm Jess. I love that I get to be part of life change for people. I love that I get to see them have hope again. Back in 2011, I was going through a divorce and my dad was battling cancer. And within just a couple months, I lost them both. Very, very difficult time. life-changing, two major life-changing events occurring within just a couple months, and it left me quite broken, devastated, heartbroken, scared and challenged, all of those things when you go through those kind of life challenges. It was working a lot. It was working 9-hour days and commuting an hour each way. And so as I was going through my own personal crisis and having now to support my kids on my own, leaving my job wasn't an option, but I knew that I wanted to try something different. I have another friend, a coworker, who was my mentor at my last agency, and I remember talking with her one day, and she said, "What do you want to do? What do you think you want to do next?" And I said, I think I want to do ministry. I think I want to rally my community around a cause. I love to public speak, and I don't know what that means. I don't know how I'll do that. Labor Day weekend 2012, Pastor Kelly said, "For anyone looking for a job, bring in your resume. We're going to pray over resumes this weekend." And so I don't remember exactly what her prayer was, but what I do remember her saying, the thing that sticks out the most, is she said, give them a job that they're not qualified for. And that just stuck out to me. So in October, just a month later, there was a job advertised in a local paper for an executive director of a local homeless shelter, a new agency that was starting up in Elk River. And I thought, boy, I have some of these qualifications, but not all of them, not really. So I sent out my resume. I was incredibly excited and hopeful, and I just thought, boy, this is right up my alley, working with families experiencing homelessness, with all the area churches. And and I got a second interview, and she called me and said, a big part of this job is public speaking. Of course it is. And I needed to prepare a speech for the second interview. It was early November when I got the call that I got the position. God, all God. Life was changing. The office was a mile from my house. I was able to work back in my community with my own church, with many churches. 19 churches in our community are on board in this ministry. We serve up to 4 families at one time, or 14 people. And what I like to say is, it's not just a homeless shelter, it's a program. It's a place for people to get off the streets, to have a safe place to be with their kids. We only take families with minor children. It's a place to start over again, get a lot of support, work through your goals, and housing is always our focus. When I talk with women who are going through hard times, I would tell you, hold on. This is for a reason. And what I know to be true in my own life is that trials become testimonies. And I believe that if God can do this for me, He can do it for anybody. There's nothing any more special about me than anybody else. You know, I'm just a human like the rest of us. I frequently say I'm just having a human experience. That's all. My name is Jess Hartfield Thurston, and I am the executive director of Great River Family Promise.
Jess, will you come up here? Yay. Hey. And Jess just got married 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago. To one very lucky dude. I can give you a mic. What we didn't make really clear in the video was how the system works with the churches. So can you briefly let us know about that really quick?
Absolutely. So we have 19 churches that support this ministry in the communities of Elk River, Zimmerman, Monticello, Big Lake, Rogers, and Otsego. And some of our churches are host churches, and that means that they host our families in the evening. So our families are actually spending the night at churches. So we have 13 churches that do that. They do it on a rotating basis for 1 week at a time, and then the families move on to the next church. And then we have support churches. And so our support churches come alongside us in many ways. They might send us volunteers to the day center. They might give us some things on our wish list, which if you went to our website, and is that posted somewhere?
We have
on the
that
sheet?
Right on the back of
yep.
your
oh,
note
the wish
sheet.
List.
Yep.
yep.
We have the wish list and the website.
Sometimes our churches will send us things on the wish list. Sometimes our support churches will plug into host churches. So people might choose to cook a meal or do an overnight shift or something like that at one of our host churches if they're part of a support church. Certainly financial donations are always welcome. We are a nonprofit. We raise all of our own funds and we're almost entirely supported by our community. Mm-hmm. We do not have any state or federal dollars that come to our program.
Yeah. So the Crossing is a support church because being a host church wasn't feasible for us during the time that it was all getting set up. So tonight when you came in, you probably saw we have a pretty big silent auction over there on the far wall by the windows. There's a variety of things that you can bid on, some beautiful gift baskets, the opportunity for Eric to take your man fishing. I'm sorry, I'm not going to let Eric take you fishing. But... so you can bid on that. Kelsey and I will take you and a friend out to dinner if you want to bid on that. Kelsey and I are super worried nobody's going to bid on that because nobody likes us that much. But hey, it's a good cause and please. And then there's Twins tickets for tomorrow's games up on the Bud Deck and just all kinds of things that are out there. So when you're doing that silent auction, that is going to go to support Grave River Family Promise. I also wanted to give you this, Jess, because this is a quote that I came across recently, and I liked it so much, we printed it on a lot of the art you can pick up in the shop. It says, she moves through the world with open arms. And when I read that, I was just reading a magazine, and I just saw that, and I had to write it down, and then we just printed it on, and it made me think of you and this segment, and so I wanted to give you this and just tell you thank you for what you do in your community.
Thank you.
And also, we're going to give the Day Center a year's supply of toilet paper.
Good.
So, I think the guys have the toilet paper. They're not paying attention at this moment. We went with the Costco brand because it comes in bigger packages. So, thank you. I think you should just parade all the way across and wait. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
So we love you. We're super proud of you. Thank you, Jess. Cool. So in your gift bag, you will see on the back of your little twirl note sheet tonight, and you can get that ready if you like, because I have a little conversation I want to have about faith tonight. But on the back of it, you'll see an invitation to the Crossing Church. If the Crossing's not your church home and you don't have one, please come back this weekend and check out the really hot pastor. This weekend, we're in a series right now called Black Sheep, and you know, we're kind of called the Black Sheep Church because we're just full of black sheep and also we're just weird. But we're doing a series right now called Black Sheep. We had the first week this past weekend with a powerful message about how we're all black sheep in some way, but how God just speaks blessings over our lives no matter what. And we don't have to clean ourselves up first. Is that good? I think that's pretty good. So this weekend, Eric is speaking about the bad girls of the Bible. And I begged so hard to be able to preach that message. And he was like, no, I'm going to do it. So I'm like, okay, fine. He's going to talk about the hooker grandmas of Jesus. So... we invite you to please come back this weekend. I will not be singing and dancing. That does not happen. But the band will be phenomenal. The teaching will be great. The coffee is delicious. And everybody who goes to this church is awesome. And you're one of those people too if you come. So there's that. On the bottom, you'll see the needs list for Great River Family Promise. And I know that some of you just, like, your heart goes out to a need and you immediately go rummaging through your house to see what you have to meet that need. I know that feeling. I'm kind of one of those people. So what we're going to invite you to do is look at the needs list on the bottom and just bring in whatever you'd like to. We're just going to kind of do a drive for Great River Family Promise this weekend. You can just drop it off at guest services at this campus, or if you go to Zimmerman or Big Lake, you can drop it off with your campus pastors there. But let's try to supply them with the things they need. And also, they do need volunteers because a lot of the churches that are host churches are very small, and so their volunteer base is very small. The Crossing is a very large church, and so we have a lot of people, and I know that each time we present an opportunity, there's somebody who that opportunity is meant for you. So if that's you, call Jessica this week and get hooked up with volunteering and being a part of that. Sound good? Okay, cool. While you're in your bag getting this out, or you're already overachievers and you already have it out, check the inside of the lid of your jar and see if you are a winner. I just heard people go, oh. That's what I said too when Kelsey reminded me I forgot to do that. So we talked about my favorite things, and then we sang about my favorite things. And Alisheva, are you wearing red shoes? Alisheva has red shoes on. Those are so sweet. I love those, right? Did anybody get a winning one? Yeah? All right, come on up. There should be two more. You are smack dab in the middle. Do you want us to deliver to you? Okay, we'll deliver to you. Anybody else? One more right here? Yay, cool. Okay, so we have for you over here on this side, under Pastor Jason's legs is a crock pot. So there you go. And then right here, behind you, Tracy, Amy, Amanda. I'm right here, crock pot. There you go. Okay, now we're gonna pass to the middle, the towels, because that's the easiest one. Raise your hand, stand up so that people can find you. And then the young lady who's coming down from the other side, you get the dishware, which I got on clearance at Kohl's. Yeah. So yay for them. Give them a hand. Make a little bit of noise. Yay. It's really heavy. It's Bobby Flay. I don't know. Whatever. You got two lids? Ooh. Oh, cool. Okay, so you get some shower gel. That's what I had. Good? Yeah? Okay, cool. Yay. Right. All right. Okay, so I'm gonna talk for just a couple of minutes because there's no way in heck that I was gonna invite this many people into my church and not tell you about Jesus. So that's what we're gonna do. Now, we were talking about a woman who moves through the world with open arms. Isn't that a cool quote? Just that idea to just move through the world with open arms. What does that mean? You know, the open arms that embrace people, open arms that protect people, open arms that celebrate and have fun and twirl. The opposite of open arms would be this, right? Which is fear, anxiety. I know that feeling too, don't you? Which would you rather have? Which would you rather have? Open arms. What holds us back? Fear so much, right? So tonight I want to tell you about a lady in scripture who lived life with open arms. She didn't have fear. We're going to talk about why. How is it that you can do crazy cool things in life without fear? And then we're just going to talk right at the end about how maybe if the truth that we get from her, if it embedded in your soul, it might change your life. Does that sound good? Yeah? Cool. Okay. So this chick, her name is Abigail. Anybody in here named Abigail? Abby? What? One loud one. Is there somebody back there too? Awesome. Very cool. Oh, there's a lot of them. There's a lot of Abbys. Everybody say hi, Abby. Okay, so we are in 1 Samuel chapter 25, verse 3. We didn't put Bibles in here tonight because you already had so much stuff to deal with, so we just put the verses up on the screen, but you don't have to put it up quite yet. I'm going to talk for just a second about the story, okay? So how many of you have heard of the guy David, King David in the Bible? He first shows up when he kills Goliath with a stone, right? So this David guy, after he grows up, he like goes around the countryside fighting battles. I don't know why. Ask Eric. He's the real pastor. And it doesn't matter in this moment. So I don't know. Anyway, so David's going through the countryside with his band of merry men and they're fighting battles and plundering. I don't know. But anyway, apparently he was on God's side. So let's just get past that part and move forward. So David and his guys, they're like going through the countryside and they needed provisions. And so they know about this rich guy. And so they decide to go and ask this rich guy for some provision. Okay. So 1 Samuel 25:3, this man's name was Nabal. And his, that's a great name, isn't it? Nabal. And his wife Abigail was a sensible and what? Beautiful woman. Who would love to be called sensible and beautiful? Kind of both. You know, like the beauty and the brains. I love it. Sensible and beautiful, but Nabal, a descendant of Caleb, was crude and mean in all his dealings. So what you have here is a sensible and beautiful woman married to a jerk face, okay? We know people like that, right? Sometimes it happens that way. You know, there's the sensible and beautiful woman, and you're like, well, how did you get married to him? You know, life happens. Those things happen. But this is just kind of this is how it is. It didn't explain anything. It's just like, this is how it is. So Nabal, why are you laughing at me? Stop laughing at me.
I'm laughing
You're making me paranoid. People are commenting around me. Oh, you're blaming the girls. Such a guy. So, here's what happens. David, going through the countryside, he sends some of his servants to go to Nabal's house. And he's like, look, Nabal, we know you and your people because we've seen you out. They're like sheep herders or whatever. And it's like during sheep shearing time. And apparently sheep shearing time was like party time for them. So they're like shearing sheep and then killing them and eating them. I don't know. So they always had a lot of provisions and a lot of wine and all that. And so David's like, this is a good time to ask this guy for help because we've always been done good by his men. Like they've never given his men any trouble, whatever. So he sends some guys. He's like, hey, can you give us some provisions? We need some provisions. So then in 1 Samuel 25 verse 10, Nabal's like, who's this fella David? He sneered to the young men. He's like, what? No. And so David's young men, they returned and they told David what Nabal said. Nabal would be like, screw you, I'm not gonna help you. And so they're like, wow, okay. So they return back to David and they're like, David, this is what he said. You know what David said? Get your swords, was his reply as he strapped on his own. So David and his guys are fixing to go open a can at Nabal's house, okay? And basically that's what he says. He's like, may God strike me dead if any member of Nabal's family remains living at the end of this day. So David is ticked off because he's like, I've always been good to his people. And this guy, he's just a jerk. He just, you know what his name means? Fool. Nabal means fool. Don't name your kid Nabal. But last week we talked at church, we talked about who? Jacob, which back then the meaning of that name was deceiver. It made me feel so bad for every guy named Jacob that I knew. But I'm sure there's other better meanings today. So anyway, Nabal meant fool. So he really wasn't his fault. His parents, you just blame it all on your parents. That's what we do. So Nabal blows them off. David's servants, they go back to David. They're like, look, he said no way. And David's like, oh, we're gonna go. And so there they go. Meanwhile, in verse 14, one of Nabal's servants went to Abigail, because he knows that she is sensible and beautiful. He went to Abigail and he told her, you need to know this and you need to figure out what to do. For there's gonna be trouble for our master and his whole family. He is so ill-tempered that no one can talk to him. She's like, yeah, I know, right? He's so ill-tempered, nobody can talk to them. So the problem comes to her. Have you ever had a moment where the problem comes to you and people are like, look, nobody can do anything about this. This is up to you. You're gonna have to make a decision. In those moments, does fear ever grip you? You're like, oh my gosh, you're expecting me to make this decision right now? And you're kind of between a rock and a hard place. You're like, this is tough. What am I gonna do? And you start to go, oh no. And your instinct is to run, you know? You're like, oh, I'm faced with this. And in this moment, like she just found out her family is in grave danger, right? Everybody go, oh. Okay, good. I just wanted to make sure you were with me. So, in verse 18, this is crazy. He's like, you gotta decide what to do. He's so ill-tempered, nobody can talk to him. Verse 18 says, Abigail wasted no time. And here's the first point of this woman who moved through the world with open arms. She wasted no time. She wasn't indecisive. She didn't go call a few friends, tweet about how stressed out she was because there were some bad guys in her life. She wasted no time. She gathered together a whole bunch of provisions. I mean, I always have these on hand. I don't know about you, but she had 200 loaves of bread, 2 wineskins full of wine, 5 sheep that had been slaughtered, nearly a bushel of roasted grain, 100 clusters of raisins, 200 fig cakes. Who likes fig Newtons? My mom likes them. They have that crunch. Who likes Oreos better? Oh, okay. So she packed all this stuff on the donkeys and sent her servants, and she said, I'll follow you shortly, but here's the next little point we have. She says, go on ahead, I'll follow you shortly, but she didn't tell her husband Nabal what she was doing. She knows when to keep her mouth shut. I don't think this is about keeping a secret from her husband. I think this is about her husband just did something profoundly stupid and she chose not to go and gripe him out. How hard is it when your husband makes a choice that you don't like or says or does something you don't like, or somebody, your friend, your girlfriend, your mom, your sister, coworker does something, and you're like, that was profoundly stupid. Like, it takes a special kind of stupid to do what you just did. And you're like, oh my gosh. You know, and even if you're gonna be nice about it, you're like, well, I wouldn't have done it that way. You know, you try to be nice about it. Anybody ever done that? Oh, I tell you, my mouth gets me in trouble. Yeah, anyway. She didn't tell him. And I think because in that moment, she realized that if she spent time trying to convince her husband to come around to her side, or to tell him that he did a stupid thing and how dangerous they were and all of that stuff, she knows that they would have likely lost their lives. So she wasted no time, and she knows when to keep her mouth shut and just do what needs to be done. And I don't know who that's for in this room, but I know it's for me, because I gotta learn sometimes to just keep my mouth shut and do what needs to be done as I move through the world with open arms. So here's what happens. So Abigail, she heads down the road. She's like, I'm not even gonna wait for him to get here. I'm gonna go head this off at the pass. So it says in 23 and 24, when Abigail saw David, she quickly got off her donkey and bowed low before him. She fell at his feet and she said, I accept all blame in this matter, my Lord. Please listen to what I have to say. Did you hear what she just said? I accept all blame in this matter, my Lord. Please accept what I have to say. Did she deserve any blame in this matter? Not at all. What kind of woman has so much confidence that she can accept blame for something she did not do in order to keep the peace and help change a situation? I'm not one to do that. I'm the first one to throw somebody else under the bus sometimes. Well, I wouldn't have done it that way, but they did. So listen to what I have to say. No, she's like, you know what? I accept all blame. That is a woman who, even though she was not well-loved, she loved her husband well in that moment. And you know what? We've got to applaud that. That is so good, because she's like, look, he is so close to bringing death on their family and on all of their worker people and everything, because apparently they had a big organization. He did all that, but she says to David, I accept all blame. She says, please don't, please. She even says, like, excuse my husband. I know he's a wicked and ill-tempered man. Please don't pay any attention to him. He's just a fool, as his name suggests. It's his parents' fault. She's like, don't blame him. It's not his fault. It's just, that's how he is. Please listen to me. Blame me. She threw herself under the bus for her husband, even though he wasn't one that seemed to deserve that kind of respect. So I don't know who you're married to, but for those of you who are married in here today, maybe you struggle to give your husband respect. Maybe he doesn't have the same faith that you do. Maybe he just doesn't do the same things the way that you do. But you know what? As we, as God's girls, move through the world with open arms, that includes our husbands. It includes allowing ourselves to just love them no matter what they're like, or no matter what their struggles are, and hold out our arms and defend them from the world too. And we can do that when our strength comes from a place that's not just them. See, people used to say to me, how can you be so confident? And I said, well, I'm well loved. Like, I blamed my confidence on Eric. So we've been married almost 20 years. And so over time, my confidence has grown a lot. And I really did, I blamed it on Eric, which is good. Like, he's like, yeah, I love her well, you know. But, you know, I was fairly confident coming into my marriage. And that's my dad Charlie's fault. I blame that on him, because he loved me well. But the truth is that they're both human, right? They're both human. What actually happened in my life, and I realized I had this wrong, was that God put people in my life to love me well, but it is God who is loving me well. Because in a heartbeat, my dad could be gone. In a heartbeat, my husband could be gone. But what would happen then? Would my confidence be gone? That's what happens if you place your hope and you base your confidence on somebody human. That's what happens if you base it on something that's temporary and earthly. But when we get all that confidence and that strength from God, it doesn't go away when the relationships that we're in changes. So number three, she's fine with undeserved blame. Oh, that's so hard. Be fine with undeserved blame. You know what? I'll take the heat for that. I'm strong enough to take it. I want to be like that. Does anybody else want to be like that? I'm just so tough that, you know, like somebody, you know, drops something in the grocery store, it smashes everybody all over the floor. I'll just stand there and be like, I did that. You know, I mean, I don't know. I want to be strong enough that I'm okay with people thinking I'm stupid sometimes, you know? Just I'll accept blame. We can do that if we know that we've got something coming from a place that is not earthly. So then here's what happens next. verse 26. Okay, so she's like, please just accept my blame. Now, my Lord, as surely as the Lord lives and you yourself live, since the Lord has kept you from murdering and taking vengeance into your own hands. And she keeps going, do you hear what she says here? She starts talking to David. She knows David is coming to kill people. Like, he is mad and he is coming to open up a can. And she knows this. She's like, he's going to kill us. He is going to kill our whole family. So she comes down, she just says, please, I'll accept the blame. And by the way, since God kept you from killing us today, he's gonna bless you. Do you catch that? It's kind of like going into the bank and being like, I am so glad to see you today, and I'm also so grateful that God allowed you to reverse that overdraft fee. Right? She just assumes that God has already fixed her problem. What if you walked into every situation assuming that God has already fixed your problem? Would you be defensive? Would you be scared? Would you be like, you know, like, what if you just walked in just with peace, with open arms, and just say, hey, guess what? I forgot to transfer some money into that account. I kind of had an overdraft fee. I was just wondering, would you mind just reversing that for me? You know, they do that because they did that for me last week. So anyway, that was very nice. I wrote a very nice note to the Wells Fargo people, and they wrote me a nice note back and gave me my $35 back. But sometimes all you have to do is just ask and trust that God's going to take care of it for you. So often we don't even ask. I was talking with somebody who manages, schedules volunteers here at the Crossing, and she was like, I was assuming that people couldn't do things, and then I realized basically what we came out was I was saying no for them by not asking. I was saying no for them by not asking. Sometimes we are afraid to ask somebody to help us. We're afraid to ask for what we need. So we just say no for them rather than just giving them the opportunity to say no themselves. And how hard is it to say no to people? It's kind of hard, right? So why don't we come in with confidence, assume God's taking care of it, and that we're going to get the yes that we need. And it doesn't mean we're cocky and we're obnoxious and you owe me this. None of that. I'm God's girl. What? You know, you're not going to do that. But what if you just go with open arms and with grace and assume that God has already fixed your problem for you? And then this is cool. She comes with a gift. Best way to open somebody's heart to you is to come with a gift. She's smart. She's sensible and beautiful. So here she says, and here's a present that I, your servant, have brought to you and your young men. Please forgive me if I've offended you in any way. Do you see that? She apologizes again for something she didn't do. She came and brought all the presents, but again, she was so humble and she comes from such a place of strength that she was able to say, please forgive me. Who finds it hard to ask forgiveness? Just be honest. Oh, I'm so with you. I'm like, I'm sorry, but you were wrong too. Like, Eric's not even gonna laugh because it's so true. It's like, he's like, shake his head. Yes, dear, we know. This is what happens when you preach, is you just preach it yourself and then you go home and go, okay, God's grace covers me too. That's good. So she says, here's the present that I, your servant, have brought you and your young men. Please forgive me if I've offended you in any way. The Lord will surely reward you with a lasting dynasty, for you are fighting the Lord's battles. You know what she did here? She uses words well. She doesn't beg and plead. She doesn't do that girly, you know. She just says, what is the language that this man needs to hear right now? He needs to hear, you are fighting God's battles. You are working hard. You are doing a good job. God's going to bless you. I've brought you a gift. Who wouldn't respond to those kind of words? If you tell your husband you're proud of him and that he provides well for you, even when you know he wishes he could provide more, how much would that build him up? If you tell your dad or your friends, you know what, girl, you look great, even though you know your friend wishes she could lose a few pounds or whatever, you just say, you're beautiful, and you just speak life over people. Speaking life over people, walking, moving through the world with open arms. What? How much good could we do? Because how little honor goes around in our world. Our world lacks honor. Our culture lacks compliments. You know why it's so hard to take a compliment? Because they're so rare. Look at the girl beside you and say, your boobs look great in that shirt. Why is that so funny? is so funny. I mean, how many times did I ask Tracy and Kelsey and Holland if my boobs were okay in that other dress? Oh my gosh, it's terrible. Like, I'm showing cleavage in church. So here's what happened. Are we on the last one? The last one? Yeah? Okay. So David replied to Abigail, because she goes on for several verses, but it would have taken us all night, in which we would be drinking the fat. But she goes on for a little while about blessings. The Lord is going to bless you. He's going to bless everything you do. And she's speaking all this life over him. He has no chance, you know, at all to like, what is he going to do? No, screw you. I'm going to go kill your husband now. He's just like, I've never seen anything like this. Isn't it cool to just blow people away with like good and grace? David replied to Abigail, praise the Lord, the God of Israel, who has sent you to meet me here today. This is what I know. A woman who moves through the world with open arms, with strength that comes from God, knowing she's deeply loved, she causes others to praise God. She causes others to praise God. So we don't want to cause others to praise us. We're just all normal, right? Normal and special. But our goal in life isn't to point people to us. Our goal in life is to point people to Jesus, because we're flawed. We're gonna fail. I will occasionally say the stupidest thing in front of everybody. I will say the wrong thing. I will forget your name. I will miss your birthday. I will trip over your child. Like, I don't know. Like, we'll mess up. We all mess up. Like Jess said in the video, we're just having a human experience here. But if we're always pointing people to Jesus, we know that they will be better off because of having been in contact with us. Now, here's the thing about that. We can't move through the world with open arms if we're too busy trying to protect ourselves and to meet our own needs, because sometimes we get so afraid that if we open up, our needs won't be met. We become vulnerable, you know? I can't be honest about that because then I'll be rejected. Like, these are the thoughts that come in our minds. I don't do things right. I eat too much. I weigh too much. I don't look right. I don't have the right job. My relationship with my husband isn't good. My boyfriend, I have this in my past. Like, we all have reasons. We all have very valid reasons why we can't move through the world with open arms, right? They're all very real, because we all have a past. We all have things that happen to us. We have lies that are spoken over us. We have negativity that is spoken over us. But if we put our eyes on Jesus, the one who gave his life so that we could be adopted back into the family of God, we can know that we always are deeply, deeply loved, that we are God's favorite. Look at the girl beside you and say, you're God's favorite. Okay, now those of you who didn't do it, look at the girl beside you and say, you're God's favorite. Now look at me. Ready? You looking at me? Say, I'm God's favorite. Did anybody find that hard to say? Sometimes it's hard because of all the voices we've heard. But here's the thing. When Jesus was dying on the cross, he wasn't going, this is for you, because you have sparkles on, you, because you have nice teeth, Belinda. You know, he didn't pick and choose. He was like, it's all of you. He came to the world with open arms. And he said, this is for you, because I know you're going to mess up, because you're just having a human experience. But I love you. And he paid the price to adopt us back into the family of God. And see, the cool thing is that God, he's our creator. He knows exactly the best plan for our lives. And if we let fear keep us back, we miss the destiny. See, Abigail, when she woke up that day, she didn't know that she was going to rescue her family single-handedly. She didn't know. All of a sudden, that opportunity presented itself, and somewhere within her, she had what she needed to just open her arms and say, I'm going to do this. What would have kept her back from doing it? Fear. That man was holding a sword and he killed people for a living. Okay? Fear would hold her back. Why didn't it? because Abigail knew her God. It wasn't because her husband loved her well, because it stands to reason that he didn't. It wasn't because she had a great support structure. It was because she knew her God. And you know this because you hear how she speaks blessing over David. She knows her God. She knows she has a perfect God who loves her with a perfect love and has a perfect plan, and she can just open her arms and just walk through her life. So today I want to direct you to one last verse. It's not on your note sheet, but if you want to write it in there, write it in there, because this one has been a big deal to me for the last few months. It's 1 John 4:18. 1 John 4:18 says, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear." Perfect love. If a perfect creator, a perfect God loves you with a perfect love and has a perfect plan for your life, don't you think maybe you could trust him? What if you gave it a shot? What if you decided today that you're gonna trust him with your life, and you're gonna let him empower you with a confidence and strength that comes from inside, and it doesn't come from any other relationship or pedigree or degrees or job or money or car or kids or lack of kids. It comes from nothing else but just that deep love, that perfect love that God gives to you. What if you held on to that? How beautiful would your destiny be when those moments come where you have an opportunity to throw out your arms and love the world? You will, because you won't be afraid for yourself, because you trust that he's gonna take care of you. I wanna invite you to bow your heads for just a minute. I wanna pray over you. Maybe you've been following Jesus for a long time, but you're kind of in a rut, and you've gotten used to trying to protect yourself and achieve what you need to get through life. What if tonight you just laid back in the arms of Jesus and let him take care of you, because perfect love casts out fear? What if you, who are new to this faith thing, you just said, you know what, I'm gonna try it. I'm gonna try it. I'm gonna ask Jesus to forgive my sins and lead my life. I would like to see what a life like that would look like. If that's you, I wanna invite you to raise your hand. If you're saying tonight, I wanna see what a life like that would look like, a life without fear in which I'm perfectly loved, can you raise your hands right now? And then just pray a prayer like this, and we'll all say it together. Just say, Jesus, thank you for giving your life for me. I don't have to be perfect because you love me. Take away my fear. Fill me with your love. Lead me from now on. Amen. Can you give a hand to all the ladies who did that just now?